So I get the joy of speaking today to all of you, and I'm a little nervous. I won't lie. I was talking to Pastor Bob last week, and he goes, "Sean, there's only one thing I want you to remember today. Make sure they come back next week." So I will try my best to do that by telling you, first of all, a bad joke. A man walking down the street, and he sees this beautiful blue vase on the ground. So he picks it up, and he starts rubbing it off to clean the dirt off of it, and a genie comes out of it. So the genie says, "Thank you so much for letting me escape my prison. It was awful in there, and just to show you how grateful I am, I'm going to give you one wish." Well, the man was elated. It's one wish. That's fantastic. But I don't know what to do, you know. So he's thinking about it for a little while, and he goes, "Well, I think I've come up with it. You know, I'm deathly terrified of planes, and I can't go on any boats because the waves, it makes me seasick, and it's really confined spaces, and I just can't go on a plane either. So, but I've always wanted to go to Hawaii. So my wish is this: I want a road built all the way to Hawaii so that I can drive there." So the genie looks at him for a minute and goes, I don't know if I can do that, man. Imagine all the pilings having to go down into the ocean floor, all the bridges that need to get built, all the asphalt that has to happen to get all the way to Hawaii. It's just too much big of an ask for me. I can't grant you that wish. I can't do it. So the man thinks again for a second time. He goes, "Well, I think I know what a second wish might be then. You know, I've always really had trouble with women. You know, hard to understand them. They're really fickle, you know, and sometimes you think you're right and other times you're wrong, and I just can't figure them out at all. So my wish is this: I wish to understand women." Genie looks at him and says, "Would you like 2 lanes or 4 lanes? And all the men said, "Yeah." Right. Next time I'll be up here, I promise I'll tell a man joke next time. Okay. Isn't that kind of what we all want in our lives, right? To understand, be understood, to know, be known. It's kind of important to all of us in our lives, isn't it? You know, we're actually in a series right now with Pastor Bob. It's called Real Life. We're speaking out of 2 Peter 1, 3 to 11. And in these passages, he talks about a lot of things in them. Mine today is going to be about knowing God, but what's in these passages is that Peter's encouraging us to have the courage to follow through on certain values so that we might enjoy the fullness of life. In those passages, you know, Peter at that time, scholars say he's probably about a year away from being crucified. If you remember, our Christian tradition tells us that Peter was crucified, martyred for his faith, and instead of being crucified normally, he was crucified upside down. And so that's sort of tradition that's kind of handed down to us. And so Peter was approaching that date. He didn't know this, but when he was writing that letter, that's how close he was to being martyred for Christ. And in it, there's a couple things that are really important to him to get across to us as Christians and the Christian church of that day. First of all, in writing that letter, he was combating heresy. And heresy is when people were saying things that were contrary to the theology about God and about Christ and how it applies to us. So heresy was talking about things that weren't true about Christ or God in relation to us. And so part of his letter was important to him was getting across that these are the real truths about Jesus Christ, and these are the real things about how you're supposed to live your life in Christ as a Christian. And the other thing that was really important to him in writing that letter at that time in his life. Now remember, he was with Jesus. He was with Jesus when he was crucified. And he then lived on 30 years approximately, and then was crucified himself after that. So what was important to him was that he was coming to the end of his life, and he was trying to encourage other Christians, here's how you live your life. I've lived a good 30 years from becoming a Christian and knowing Jesus and being filled with the Holy Spirit and sharing the gospel, living his life. He's gone 30 years. And what he was trying to encourage us was that how important it was to follow these principles. And what's neat about that whole passage is the fact that this is Peter we're talking about. So he has lived a full life of being a Christian, and now he's giving us advice, and I can't think of a better person to tell us about how we need to, or the important things about living a Christian life, especially over that long a period of time, and how important it is. One of the things that he talks about in that whole section is he talks about knowing God and having knowledge of God. Do you know what the difference is between knowing about something and knowing something? Knowing about something and knowing something? Or knowing about someone and knowing someone? Man, I'm a really big fan of The Rock. I don't know if you knew that or not. I'm just going to share that right now, but super fan of The Rock. And Dwayne Johnson, he's in the movies, he's a wrestler, you know, all those sort of things. And so I know it seems sort of a little silly for me, a guy my age, liking a wrestler, but I do like him a lot. So when I talk about The Rock sometimes with my friends, you know, it's never in because I have a relationship with him, is it? I'm a fan of The Rock, but I'm not a friend of The Rock. I know about The Rock, but I don't really know The Rock, right? Or think about Cliff Clavin. Do you remember Cliff Clavin from Cheers? Has anybody actually not seen Cheers? I'm going to ask that first because I'm going to see. Do you know the movie? Do you know the TV show Cheers? Yeah, I really dated myself, I know. Yeah. Yeah, there's quite a few of you. Cheers was about a bar. It was a TV sitcom about a bar where these guys all got together all the time and all kinds of hijinks happened. But there was one character named Cliff Clavin on that TV show. And every time he would interject with the most useless facts ever for anything that was getting involved and stuff. So he was always on the TV show, so for some reason they kept him around in their group of friends, but he would always throw these facts out that actually had nothing to do with anything that was in the TV show itself, right? So that would be something where you would know about something, right? Where maybe wouldn't have the same sort of depth of knowledge in incorporating into your life. You know, I came across this video this week that really illustrates it pretty well. So why don't you watch this with me?
Do I believe in wife? I mean, yeah. Who doesn't? I believe in wife.
So do you think you live your life any differently because you believe in wife? I mean, yeah,
I put the toilet seat down, if that counts.
Do you ever talk to wife?
No, man, I don't really talk to wife. I'm not one of those wife nuts.
Oh yes, I believe in mom.
What do you think mom is like?
I think she's big and powerful and she wants me to be happy.
What makes you happy?
Being comfortable and doing my own thing and not being bothered by my sister.
Anything else?
Getting lots of toys.
Does mom ever ask you to do anything?
If she did, that would make me very happy.
Sounds like mom is pretty easygoing.
Oh yes, she's very nice. I think she's smiling on me right now.
Yeah, I believe in boss. I mean, my views probably aren't orthodox, but sure, yeah, I believe in boss.
Can you describe some of your views of boss?
Well, I think boss is really whatever we make him or her out to be. I mean, each person decides what kind of boss they want to believe in. And I don't think anybody should try to impose their views or act like their boss is the true boss. I mean, that's just intolerant.
So you don't think it matters whether you're right about boss or not?
Well, I don't really use words like right or wrong. I mean, I think it's all relative. You may see one thing about Boss, and I see another thing about him or her. Maybe you think that Boss says things like, get back to work and be on time, and that's fine, whatever, I'm okay with that, but don't act like I have to believe in that kind of boss.
I really enjoyed that video when I first saw it, because it really pokes fun a little bit at sometimes how we talk about God and our relationship with him, doesn't it? And how he talked about his wife and how she talked about mom or boss, right? So in looking at that video, you sort of are struck with the ridiculousness of some of the conversations that were going on. Imagine if you were in that video, right? What would your relationships look like if you acted the same way in the video that these people were acting? Married guys, I'm looking at all of you. Imagine if we had that same relationship with our wives. We talked about wife, right? But we didn't communicate with wife, have a relationship with her, a deep understanding with wife, expectations, those sort of things. We just kind of sort of, I guess I talk, or I don't really talk to wife because I'm not a wife nut, right? Can you imagine that? Imagine being in that video. Right? How about those of you that are couples? I'm pointing over here because we have more of our couples over here that aren't married yet. But imagine that. Imagine being engaged or in a relationship with somebody else and you had that same kind of thing going on with your significant other. Imagine the kind of relationship that would be. That would be awful, wouldn't it? Yeah. Or your boss like that. Like, man, I wish I had a job like that, right? If we had that same sort of relationship with our bosses too, where maybe boss is there, but I'm not really quite sure, right? Right? What would your Christian life look like if you had a relationship with God that looked like that? What would your Christian life look like if you had a relationship with God that looked just like that video? You've said the same things as that video said. And let me ask you this question. Do you think that it would be living the fullest of your life that God has in store for you with that kind of relationship? So let me ask the question again. Is your relationship with God like that video that we just saw? Do you know what's really encouraging about what we're going to talk to today in 2 Peter? Is that all of these questions that I just asked are in the Bible. The Bible encourages us to have a deeper relationship with Jesus, and you know what? It even tells us why that deeper relationship is important for us today and in life now. I'm going to read this scripture for you, man. This is what we're going to be talking about. From 2 Peter chapter 1, and it says this. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness mutual affection, and to mutual affection love. If you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. In this case, knowledge. Knowing Jesus. It will keep you ineffective, or it will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in knowing Jesus. But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sins. So what is this knowledge that Peter's talking about? What do you think this knowledge is that he says? In the beginning of the verse, he talks about, for this reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness and goodness knowledge. It's kind of interesting that he has a bit of a separation there between faith and knowledge, right? Sometimes when we think of faith, we think, okay, well, that means knowing God, being in relationship with him. And it's interesting here that Peter actually separates it a bit. In this case, faith, he's talking about, we understand that Jesus died on the cross for my sins, that I am a sinful man, that I accept what Jesus has done so that I might have a relationship with God, secure a place in heaven, and walk through this life together with him. That's sort of what faith is, right? Recognizing that Jesus is the Messiah. And in this case, Peter separates that with knowledge, saying, no, there's something deeper than just faith. There's something deeper that all of us should be doing living. Now, remember, I'm going to go back and talk to, or just remind us what we talked about before. Remember, Peter is at the end of his life, and he's saying, these are the important things that you need to do in order to live life as a Christian and to live it to the fullest. You know, in this case, when he's talking about knowledge like this, he's talking about it being a dynamic relationship with Jesus. It's not just book smarts. But knowing in this capacity, in this scripture, what Peter wants us to do is know Jesus deeply and intimately. Knowing Jesus deeply and intimately. What do you think knowing Jesus deeply and intimately looks like? Can you think in your mind, well, okay, how do I have that relationship with my spouse? Or how do I have that relationship with my kids or my best friend? What would knowing Jesus look like in that case? You know, I think it would be like talking, right? You know, when I, you know, with Tracy, my spouse, like she's the third person or something, but with Tracy, my wife, you know, knowing my wife, part of that is expectations, you know, what she expects of me in our marriage, what I expect of her. I would only know those things unless if we communicated, right? So there's a certain level of expectation, I guess, that's involved in knowing a person. There's an expectation of love, support. There's an expectation of compatibility, those things. So that would be a bit of what knowing a person is like, right? And I think it's similar to in what Peter wants from us in our lives with Jesus. Knowing Jesus would mean having a relationship with him where we're communicating with him. How does Jesus communicate back with us? We do that in prayer. God communicates with us through the Bible, right? We show our expression of love to Jesus through singing, through worshiping God. You know, that would be a way of knowing God even more fully. We show our expression of love, and Jesus shows his expression of love to us when we live out the principles in the Bible that help us to live a righteous life. That's that aspect of knowing Jesus that Peter is encouraging us to do. So I know the question you're asking yourself right now. You're going, okay, well, Peter wants me to know Jesus, but why? Why should I know Jesus? I mean, what's in it for me, I guess, right? And here's where he says this. And this is why it's important to know Jesus. He says it in 2 Peter. He says, for if you possess these qualities, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in knowing Jesus. But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sins. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort to confirm your calling and election. Calling election being what Jesus has done for us. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. You will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In this case, Peter is telling us this. If you know Jesus beyond faith and beyond goodness that I want you to develop, I want you to develop this knowing God deeply and intimately. When you know Jesus in this way, you will never stumble. You will receive a rich welcome in our eternal kingdom with Jesus Christ. So you will receive this, you will never stumble, and you will see heaven. Those are the two things that Peter says are important for us in knowing Jesus. You know what's interesting about that, though, is that Jesus says it a little differently. And this is what 2 Peter was saying there, but Jesus says it a little differently. Interestingly enough, when Jesus talks about living our lives to you and the promises that he makes, he often does not refer to heaven being the end goal, but he has something else in mind for all of us in knowing him. And this is what Jesus said. And this is in Matthew 10. Now remember, this is to the disciples, okay? So this is to the disciples that Jesus is talking, all right? And this is what they're going to be anticipating in life. He says this, I am sending you out. Well, actually, let's back up a little bit. Let's actually talk about the context, because that's really important. At this point, Matthew 10, where Jesus is there, Jesus and the disciples really were rock stars, right? I use rock stars because at that time, there would be thousands of them congregating around Jesus, wanting to get to know Jesus, touch him, hearing this masterful teacher, and you know, watching the miracles that were taking place. And so around them was a posse that would be following them around, fans of Jesus that were always following him. So I can imagine at that point, those disciples, they felt pretty awesome, right? There's all these people congregating around Jesus, and they're the inner friends and the close circle of Christ. And so, you know, they gotta, you kind of gotta get through them to get to Jesus, right? So I can imagine that they're feeling pretty awesome. And then Jesus hits them with this ball, and he says this, I am sending you out like sheep among wolves. Therefore, be as shrewd as snakes and innocent as doves. Be on your guard. You will be handed over to local councils and flogged in the synagogues. On my account, you will be brought before governors and kings and witnesses to them, to the Gentiles. But when they arrest you, do not worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you will be given what to say, for it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. So imagine that, right? Put yourself in the disciples' shoes. They're thinking they're pretty awesome. They think the Savior has come. The Messiah has come. Jerusalem and the Jews will rule the earth. And, you know, so that's their context at that point. And then Jesus says again, you're going to be flogged and you're going to get arrested. So I think if I were in that group, I'd be like, what? Jesus, did I hear that right? I'm not sure I signed up for this. Flogged and arrested? I think that'd be my reaction. I'm assuming that'd be your reaction, wouldn't it? You know, everything's going just awesome. I'm feeling like a rock star. And then Jesus says, you're going to get flogged and arrested. It gets worse. Then Jesus says this, brother will betray brother to death, father his child. Children will rebel against the parents, have them put to death. You will be hated by everyone because of me. But the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. When you are persecuted in one place, flee to another. Truly I tell you, you will not finish going through the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. So Jesus goes on from saying, you're going to be flogged, arrested, you are going to be hated and chased out of town until I return. Until I return. Imagine that. So that's what Jesus is giving you, the promise that he's giving to these disciples. He's saying this. This is what's going to happen. Arrested, flogged, hated, chased around. Chased around. But you know, he finishes off with this. He says this. So don't be afraid of them. For as there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs of your head are numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Here's what Jesus promised for us, friends. Here's what Jesus promised. He never promised a pain-free, magical life. He never promised that. He said this to the disciples, he said, you're going to be arrested, you're going to be flogged, you're going to be hated, chased around town. He never said, I'm going to stop those things from happening to you. But he said, that's what's going to happen. This is your life, disciples. Now, understand this, friends, right? Understand this. This was a message to the disciples, but there's still principles there of what Jesus was talking about for all of us, okay? Those were very specific things that were going to happen to the disciples. But the same thing can be said for us in our lives, can it, friends? Right? I think this is what Jesus was saying to us in that. This is what I'm going to promise you. Life is going to be full of pain, sorrow, love, elation, grief, anger, job loss, financial breakdown, marital infidelity, heartbreak, strife, rage, joy, passion, chaos. That's what Jesus is saying to us, right? But this is the important point that he's saying. You don't have to be afraid. You don't have to be afraid. You don't have to be afraid. So let's think back about what 2 Peter was saying, right? 2 Peter was saying this. You need to have faith, goodness, knowledge. You need to know Jesus Christ. You need to know Jesus Christ. And why is that important? Because you get to participate in the life that God wants for you. And what that life is about going through those times, those tough times that we have in our lives that are going to come for each one of us at some point, going through it with him with the knowledge that I don't have to be afraid because this can't destroy my soul. I don't have to be afraid of those things. You know, it says in the Bible at time, other times where it says God can turn bad things to good. But the only way a person would know that is knowing Jesus Christ. When somebody looks into your life and says, man, that's terrible what's going on. God's abandoned you and what's going on right now? There's no God and stuff. But you can say in your heart, no, I knew these circumstances were going to happen, but I know Jesus and I know what it says in the Bible. And he made a promise to me that I don't have to be afraid, that he has got my soul and I don't have to be afraid of my circumstances, that what is awful here, God can turn it into something good. And that is what knowing Jesus is all about. Friends, isn't that something you want to know and experience in your own life? Not just talking about Jesus. Not just saying, hey, God, if you're there, going to him in crisis moments. But isn't that something you want for your life, to have that such a deep knowledge and know God personally so deeply and intimately that you can go through those tough times in your life and know that Jesus is with you and that I don't have to be afraid? Man, friends, that's something I want in my life. That's something I want in my life. You know, my mom, as you know, some of you there, 2 weeks ago, I got a phone call. I was at a friend's house, and I got a phone call from my sister telling me my mom was rushed to the hospital from Nelson to Kelowna, and she's on life support, and that the nurses told the family that we need to get there right now. So I immediately left and traveled, got to the airport, flew into Kelowna, went to see my mom. I know, with friends, it was awful. I know some of you can empathize with me right now because you've gone through similar situations with your own parents. And truly, it was the most awful thing I had ever experienced. You know, and isn't this true about moms, right? I have, growing up, my parents divorced. I have a number of abandonment issues in my own life. But seeing your own mother on her deathbed, that dissolves pretty quickly, doesn't it? I remember sitting there in that hospital room with my mom and weeping. And I remember begging God for one more chance just to tell her I loved her and to share Jesus with her. My mom doesn't know Christ. My family doesn't know Christ. So I remember sitting there going like that. My sister arrived soon after. We got together with the doctor and the nurses. And they all told us the same thing. My mom was on 100% life support. There's varying degrees of how much life support your body would need when you go on it. And my mom in this case was on 100%. So she, if they plugged that, unplugged the machine right then, she would have died immediately. So now, the reason my mom got to this state was she has sarcoidosis. It's a lung condition in which her lungs become fibrous, and which means they can't take in oxygen as easily. And so it's there. She's had this for years, and it's just continuing to get worse. And she developed pneumonia on top of that. So the two things together complicated so much that she had to go on life support, right? So that night, with my sister and the doctors there, they told us that you need to go home. We're going to meet together as a family. And they told us that my mom was in a state where she wasn't going to come out of this. They weren't going to be able to unplug the life support and get mom up. We were trying to look for best case scenarios, couldn't find them. And the doctor said even her trying to get her to be a little more alert, they couldn't even do that. She couldn't come out of the sedation enough that they could even get to that point. And they said, the next day when you come in, we're gonna have to discuss taking your mom off life support, pulling the plug on her. So friends, I went home that night, and this was on Saturday night, and I was expecting to come home Sunday. I was expecting to go to the hospital and unplug the machine with my family. And and that's when Pastor Bob shared with you that I was away in town on the Sunday morning. So we arrived, and the nurses said, your mom made it through the night, and she's in very, very critical condition, but we're going to continue to monitor her, and we'll make another decision the next day. So, friends, you prayed for my family on Sunday morning. My mom came off of life support, and she was knocking on heaven's door. My mom came off life support on Tuesday morning, all right? The doctor came into the room, talked to my family, and said, your mom, I can't explain it, but she's made a miraculous recovery. It's, it's amazing that she's able to get this off life support. She was still very sick, but the fact that she even was able to do that was miraculous. He goes, I don't even know how it happened, stuff. So, friends, I know how it happened, right? I mean, it was a praying church that helped this miracle to happen. You know, through this, my sister had to come face to face with the same thing, seeing my mom in this condition, and having to kind of come to some conclusion about what a miracle is, and how could a miracle have happened. You know, some might say, oh yeah, no, she's just too stubborn to die, right? And that would be my stepdad. He would say that, right? And I would say something like, well, she was not stubborn enough to make herself heal herself in the first place. What would change now? But going through this whole process, friends, if I didn't know God, I couldn't have explained how something miraculous had happened like that. I couldn't have gone through the grief and the of what I was experiencing through that without knowing God. I couldn't, at this point, even, if I didn't know God, I couldn't now even have the conversation with my sister about a miracle that took place to share the good news of hope with her, taking something so terrible that something's happened now where my sister is now investigating faith and wants to know more about it. You know, that's me knowing God. You know, on the flip side of that is my mom, and not knowing God, not having a deep personal relationship with her. The flip side of that is my mom being just terrified of dying. I remember when she came off life support and began the process of her coming out of the sedation, begging me repeatedly over and over again, please help, please help. My mom was terrified to die. She even talked about it with my sister too, just absolutely terrified. Friends, I want my mom to know God, to know that she doesn't need to be terrified, to know that her condition that she's going through right now is terrible, but God is walking with her, and at the end, she has a rich reward in heaven. In knowing God, that's what I want for my mom. And friends, that's what I want for all of us. I know all of us go through bad circumstances in our lives, and I want you to know God well enough and know him so fully that you can walk through those things and just say, I am not afraid. I am not afraid. I am not afraid. Let's just close our eyes. And as we do that, I'm going to invite our servers to come forward for communion. What a special day to be talking about this and to be experiencing communion today. So I want to go back to those questions I asked before that I'm hoping prompted you something in your heart. How do you know God? Do you know God like the guy in the video that we just saw? Do you talk to God the same way? Or do you know God enough that you can go through life when the bad things happen? Do you know him well enough and trust him enough to believe it when he says, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Do you know God well enough to say, Lord, if I actually ever get to that hospital bed and I know that I'm going to die, I'm not going to be afraid. I know you, God. I know you, Jesus. I know you, God. I want you to let that rattle around in your heart a little bit here. Think about it. Let your spirit just chew on it a little bit. Just say, God, how do I know you? How do I know you? Peter tells you what you should do for your life, and I want to encourage you in the same way too. You want to know God like that. And you can meet him like that too. How do I get to know God? I get to know God more deeply by prayer. I get to know God more deeply by reading his word, by believing what he promises in it, by living my life in a way that looks like Jesus to others, and that I trust that, Lord, you've got my best interests in mind when you ask me to do things in the Bible, Lord Jesus. When you ask me to be committed to my wife, when you ask me to be a moral person, those things, Lord, I know I trust you in that, Jesus. And I want to know you more and deeply in my life.